Hi, I'm Rolf Klesen. I'm patent attorney with Michalski Uttermann & Partner in Düsseldorf. And today's guest is Uli Storz. Uli Storz is a biologist, and he has gathered a lot knowledge about the patents related to COVID. And I'm happy that you are here, and we are talking about the COVID patents today, right?
Yes, thank you. May I just start one word, because I very often hear the term the COVID patent must be lifted or must be suspended. And, well, the first message is there is no such COVID patent. And there's a couple of reasons for it, and maybe we discuss that in different aspects. Yeah.
Right, because there are patents about the vaccine itself, and there are patents about the process to make the vaccine, and there are a lot of maybe you can explain,
yes.
What are the different
yes.
types of patents that well, are... I mean, maybe to give the listeners a framework, a rough framework, there is a lot of discussion about waiving patent rights.
Right.
Maybe first we understand what the patents are and what does it mean, waiving of patent rights. And maybe we start with what patents are actually, what patents is this about?
Right. Yeah. Maybe one step ahead. First of all, I think it is an incredible achievement that society has been able to make a vaccine against COVID in this record speed. And despite all criticism with regard to, well, that was probably not properly made, I fully disagree with it. I think these vaccines have been tested to the highest standard possible. So I think all criticism is regarding the approval process is at least with regard to the BioNTech, the Johnson & Johnson, the AstraZeneca and the Moderna is not applicable. Maybe with regard to the Russian, because there was a lot of political pressure, and maybe also with regard to Chinese vaccines. But with regard to the ones I mentioned before, I think there's all criticism with regard to insufficient testing is not applicable, fully not applicable. So it's actually a gift that we received. And of course, the issue is that there is an inequality in global distribution of this vaccine. And I think we all agree that, well, let's call it the Northern Hemisphere has an obligation to support the Southern Hemisphere in achieving sufficient vaccine supplies. I think there can be no doubt about it. The question, of course, is what role do patents play in this problem? And I think, and that is, I mean, because patents have often been made responsible for this inequality. And we carried out some studies. We published on these studies, and
I,
we think
I link these articles below in the description.
Yes. Thank you for doing that. One is published. One is in submission and not yet published. But what I believe is that it is too simplified to blame patents for that vaccine in inequality. Now, let's first start with one point: COVID 19 or SARS-CoV-2 was discovered in late 2019. And Chinese scientists have, well, uploaded the genome of SARS-CoV-2 in early 2020. I think it's in the article. I think it's January, February. I don't know exactly right now. So we now have September 2021. So it is about 20 months past the day that the genome was uploaded into public databases. So technically, we know SARS-CoV-2, or we know the details of SARS-CoV-2 only for about 20 months. And something that a lot of people don't know is that patent applications, after being filed, are kept secret for 18 months. Well, we call it the U-boat phase or whatever, I don't know. And after 18 months, they are getting published. This means that if someone speaks about the COVID patent, these COVID patents, if they exist out there, we simply don't know them because they are not yet published. That is maybe one point. And because they are not yet published, they cannot be used against competitors to block competitors out of the market. So the first, misconception is that there would be patents protecting the actual COVID-19 vaccines to block competitors out of the market. These patents are, at this point of time, not yet No, we don't know them.
Right. And because they are certainly not yet granted.
Yes, and because we don't know them, no judge, the judges also don't know them. So they cannot be used against competitors. That's maybe the first message we need to discuss. Now, the second point is, of course, there is earlier IP that has been generated in the time before that protects composition of matter that is now part of the COVID vaccines. And the best example is the BioNTech vaccine, which is an mRNA vector that comprises, for example, in its lipid nanoparticles, specific lipids, or which has a specific mRNA sequence that is not 100% identical to the mRNA sequence of the viral spike protein for some reasons. And of course, these elements are or can be subject of patent protection. There is no doubt about that. And of course, this reflects in a way the long, and let me focus on mRNA vaccines, because that is, I have a very good understanding of the patent background of the mRNA vaccines. And of course, that background IP reflects the decade-long development of mRNA vaccines. So the concept of using mRNA as a vaccine has been introduced in 2000. So 20 years ago, by Ingmar Noer, who was the founder of CureVac, who is now in discussion of being awarded the Nobel Prize, although his CureVac's vaccine failed in practical testing. So that's the tragedy of life, that you get a Nobel Prize but your vaccine might fail. It has not yet failed completely, but of course there is a tragic element in that.
But he discovered mRNA vaccines.
Yes. Yeah. So that is one milestone of mRNA vaccine development. Then there was Katalin Karikó from University of Pennsylvania, who is now a member of the board of BioNTech, who found out that if you use specific uridine variants, methyl pseudouridine, then you make mRNA vaccines less immunogenic, not immunogenic, but less, so that the body reaction triggers on an immune reaction on the produced protein, but does not direct itself against the mRNA per se. That is only two examples of the 20-year development of mRNA vaccines. And all these elements were protected by third-party patents. And that is, of course, sure. Now, I think the Northern Hemisphere has an obligation to support the Southern Hemisphere in achieving sufficient supplies in vaccines. And there was an initiative, in particular by India and by the government of South Africa, with the WHO and also with the WTO, so the two UN organizations which are focusing either on trade-related aspects or on health-related aspects. And so the initiative was to waive the COVID patents, because the COVID patents would have to be made responsible for that lack of supply or lack of access of countries in the Southern Hemisphere to the COVID vaccines.
But you found out something quite
interesting,
right?
Yes.
A little bit funny.
Yeah, I mean, it's tragic when you see people dying. It's really tragic.
Yeah,
but
I know.
But the point is, the argument was that the industries in, for example, India or South Africa would be blocked to make their own vaccines because of these COVID patents. So what we did in a study, and we did this not alone, we did this with colleagues, with patent attorney colleagues from Brazil, Pakistan, Mexico, Egypt, India. We tried to find out, we identified all the background patents that protect elements of the BioNTech vaccine. And then we checked whether these background patents have ever been put into national faces in these countries, Brazil, Pakistan, Mexico, Egypt, India. And we found out that not a single of these patents has been put into national faces in these countries. With one exception, for India, there is two BioNTech patents that protect the 5' UTR, but these patents are not yet granted in India. And we have a very good understanding of the Indian patent system, and there are sincere doubts that they will ever get granted.
Right.
Which means that on the example of the BioNTech vaccine, there is no blocking IP in those target countries that mm-hmm. could block those countries from making the vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
So the argument that patents would be the reason for the inequitable access, that argument is simply wrong.
Right.
It is simply not applicable. Now, of course, there's other reasons, and the reason is maybe know-how transfer. Supply of ingredients, maybe support in upscaling production. Of course, all these reasons apply, but patents are not the reason. And there's there's maybe two examples that make me a little bit uncomfortable. One is that the US government under the Biden administration has declared sympathy for the initiative and has also declared support for a patent waiver. At the same time, the US government has put in place an export ban on ingredients for those vaccines.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, that goes as far as syringes
mm-hmm.
and glass vials. So how can you, it's simply not honest to blame the patents, but at the same time, keep all the ingredients that you need for making the vaccine inside your country. And the term for that is vaccine nationalism. There's another example, and that is the world's largest vaccine supplier is Serum Institute in India. They deliver vaccines into about 170 countries in the world. And they have a license from AstraZeneca, Oxford University, for the AstraZeneca vector vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
And we all have the pictures in mind of sick people in India, and they really have a terrible development, or at least had a terrible development of the COVID disease. And there is an initiative by the World Health Organization that's called COVAX, under which vaccines are distributed in particular into African countries. And the Serum Institute was supposed to be the main supplier for that initiative
mm-hmm.
on the basis of the AstraZeneca vaccine, which is a vector vaccine. And then when the death figures went up in India, the Indian government put an export ban in place for those vaccines which were meant to be delivered to the COVAX initiative, which I think is understandable in a way, because they wanted to protect their own population before they delivered that into other countries. But the term for that, if you put it in bad words, is vaccine nationalism. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I'm not blaming the Indian government for that, because I find it understandable. But at the same time, the Indian government blamed patents for mm-hmm. blocking access. And that is simply, that's not consistent.
So the inequality about the distribution of the vaccine is not caused by patents, but by many other different factors, among them
right.
vaccine nationalism, or maybe the lack of know-how, how to
yeah.
produce this vaccine. Yeah,
exactly right. And I saw in some internet, I'm not as much in social media as you are, but I saw in some internet discussions when that argument is raised that it is also a problem of know-how transfer, then that argument was very often blocked as or labeled as, well, that is post-colonialism.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we say well, maybe Indian companies don't have the know-how to make the mRNA vaccine,
mm-hmm.
that was labeled as post-colonialism. And that, of course, I mean, first of all, it's not correct. And second, it doesn't bring us any further. So
right.
it doesn't help us in any aspect.
No. It's
we just simply
a blaming
yeah,
argument.
We simply cannot ignore that. I mean,
right.
so in fact, I think the reason for that inequitable access is manifold, and there's, of course, we are in the obligation to support the Southern Hemisphere, but it is way more complicated than only waive the patents, right?
Right.
And that is my concern. That's my point.
Right.
Yeah.
And Then there is also an instrument of compulsory licenses.
Right.
So, for example, if South Africa would have the opinion that they need this vaccine, they can also say, okay, we impose an compulsory license on these patents. They don't need WHO-based waiver of
right.
patents worldwide, right? Maybe you can elaborate
exactly.
on this.
Exactly. So well, in Germany, the legal bar for placing a compulsory license into place is very high. But that does not apply to other countries. And of course, the possibility for countries to put compulsory licenses into place is regulated under the TRIPS contract, which is a contract that obligates all member states of the World Trade Organization to respect a certain level of IP protection, right?
Mm-hmm.
But within that framework, countries may put in place compulsory license under specific circumstances. And the Indian government, the Indian law, even allows compulsory licenses not only in an emergency case where the local population does not have enough access to a particular drug,
mm-hmm.
but also for exportation into other countries,
mm-hmm.
if in other countries
mm-hmm.
There would be no sufficient supplies.
Like, for example, for the Serum Institute
right.
delivering vaccine to Africa.
That's right. Which I'm not 100% sure whether that regulation is compliant with the TRIPS Treaty. I haven't checked that. But so there are already legal means for those countries which now demand the suspension of the patent rights to not suspend, but to put a compulsory license into place
mm-hmm.
on such patents. Which brings us back to the BioNTech case. However, you cannot put a compulsory license into place against a patent which does not exist.
Right.
Right?
Which you don't know.
Yeah. Which either you don't know or which has never been put into power in that respective
right. not
target
granted.
State. Or
yeah.
never ever initiated national face in that country,
right.
you see.
Mm-hmm.
So, in a way, you and I, we are lobbyists. We are lobbyists of the patent system.
Right.
Right. And I'm well aware that might be a problem when we provide an opinion on patent aspects, that from outside that might always be thought, well, these guys are lobbyists. But, I mean, we cannot deny the facts.
Right.
We cannot, and
right.
anyway, yeah.
So what would be your main takeaway for our listeners? What would you tell them, okay, this is what they need to bring back
yep.
From this video?
Yeah, well, first of all, we now think that it was a very easy game to make these vaccines. Well, it took only 8 months to achieve market, to do the entire development process. Which is record speed, because before COVID, the fastest vaccine that came to the marketplace was a mumps vaccine, and that took 5 years. So in a way, we now think, well, that's an easy game, and because it is supposed to be so easy, well, it is also easy to demand a patent waiver,
mm-hmm.
because well, when mm-hmm. it was so simple, where's the invention? And so what we forget is that there are quite a few companies out there who failed in their clinical trials for making the vaccine.
Right.
And among them, not only CureVac, and I think the CureVac vaccine is not yet doomed, but at least we know that it did not perform very well. But other companies like Merck or Sanofi, mm-hmm. Pasteur, also failed in making their vaccine. So mm-hmm. the point that BioNTech, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson and AstraZeneca were so successful, that should not, well, take away our awareness for the fact that it is not an easy game to
right.
make these vaccines.
It was just the tip of the iceberg, like
right.
a couple of successful companies and a lot of
right.
companies that failed.
And of course, we learn about the success stories,
right.
but all the failed stories, they never
right.
get the public awareness.
Right.
So it's, and we cannot forget, in particular with regard to the mRNA vaccines, that the success we are facing now is a result of 20 years
mm-hmm.
of consistent development
mm-hmm.
where investors, private investors, put
mm-hmm.
their money in, where scientists devoted their life for.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it is way too simple to now say, okay, now that we have the vaccines, get rid of all these patents.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that is simply, in a way, we need to think about the future. There will be new pandemia coming. Mm-hmm. And there needs to be an incentive for scientists and for investors to invest their resources into the development of these, of new vaccines or new drugs against new diseases.
Right.
Yeah.
So now my final question is, if people want to get consulting regarding vaccines or maybe even the COVID patent system and learn more from you, where can they reach you?
We have a webpage, and I think you know that.
Right.
We are based in Düsseldorf, in Germany, but we have a European reach. So we serve from our office in Düsseldorf. We serve clients in all countries in Europe. We also do active counseling for clients in the United States and Asia. So people sometimes ask me, okay, for example, what is the best combination? If I have the first shot in BioNTech, should I take the second shot in AstraZeneca? That's not our business.
So, people want to know more about the patent situation,
right,
to understand this patent situation
better.
And get paid consultant.
Yes.
Consultancy.
Of
course.
Yeah, contact us. Contact us. Right. We are always happy to help. We are, it is such an exciting development that we are facing, and we are always happy to help. And call us, send us an email, go to our website,
mhpatent.net.
Yeah, go to Rolf's channel, which is excellent. So, because there's hardly any fields out there where the degree of misunderstanding is as high as it is in IP or patent protection.
Right.
And I mean, you know what I'm speaking about.
Yes.
Yeah.
I try to remedy this.
Yeah. with a lot of success.
You know. Okay. Well, thank you very much for being on my YouTube channel and on the video.
I thought you would say on the show.
On the show.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, happy to be here. And welcome again to our firm. Thank you.
Thank you very much.